just come off?
Yeah.
Hey, look at that.
Well, yeah. I'll screw this up, don't worry.
So, I'm used to having somebody up here talking and asking me stuff, so. What do you want to know? Yeah, any questions? I guess we could start it off that way, and maybe I'll think of something to say. Yeah?
Who would be your favorite director to work with?
My favorite director to work with, there are two of them. Patrick Lussier, who did My Bloody Valentine 3D and Drive Angry, and Fred Decker, who did Night of the Creeps, my all-time favorite film that I worked on. Certainly not the most successful film I've ever been in. Lethal Weapon, the first one, was probably the most successful. But those are my two favorite directors. They're just wonderful guys, and I wish I could have been in Monster Squad with Fred and those guys. I think that's even a better movie than Night of the Creeps. It's a little quicker paced and more fun. And Fred always worried about the pacing. I think Night of the Creeps was his first, and it gets a little slow at times, I think. And I watched the ending, I don't know if any of you were over at the screening in Mall of America of Halloween 3 the other night, but I watched part of the ending of that and I thought, oh, come on, man. Get, kick the shit out of this girl, get rid of her, get to the phone and stop the goddamn and save all the children of this generation. Get on with it. And I remember, though, when we were shooting, that Tommy Lee Wallace, who directed it, wanted every shot, you know, a shot of you and your feet getting out of the car and her foot grabbing your leg, or her arm grabbing your leg. And it was, I like movies that move quick, especially near the end when you're galloping for the curtain. It's the same as doing a play. If you're doing a play in a theater, you know, you want to get, the audience has been there for 2 hours and you want to get to the end. Thanks a lot, Thomas. Thanks, appreciate it. So, but I thought Fred did a really great job on Night of the Creeps. And Patrick on both of his too. It's a shame. I felt bad that for Patrick. Is this working all right? Can you hear me okay?
Yeah.
That Patrick, I thought, did a great job on My Bloody Valentine 3D, and I think it did real well for Lionsgate. And then we did Drive Angry down in Shreveport, Louisiana, which was a wonderful film. It's all work to me. It's my job. It's how I make my living, and it's how I've done it for 47 years. But so it's places that I go and the fun that we have while making the movie, and sometimes the movie is the least of it. And though Drive Angry was not the least of it, the movie, I thought it was terrific, but it didn't sell very well at all. And Shreveport was great fun, and I saw one of the best air shows at Barkstrom or Backstrom Air Force Base right outside of Shreveport that I've ever seen in my life, with big B-1 bombers they brought in from North Dakota, and fast fighters that could knock you down with the sound of their power and engines flying by at like the speed of sound. And at the same time, they were able to fly by almost hovering. Really weird. It was wonderful. But anyway, that movie didn't make any money. Patrick was gonna make a Halloween 3 along the Rob Zombie storyline, where I was gonna be a psychiatrist taking care of the main girl, Laurie something? Is that her name? I don't know. And like Arkham, but like in an insane asylum somewhere, and but taking care of her in the worst kind of way. As you can imagine, Todd Farmer and Patrick Lussier having me in that movie. But because Drive Angry didn't do well, they took the money away and we never made that. He's hoping to someday, but I have my doubts. So what's a haps? Got any other questions? Yes, sir.
When you were in the Breathe 11 with Mel Gibson, did you give him any pointers on his naked butt in the moonlight, since you did one in Halloween?
Are you kidding me? No. 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 That is a silly question. No, I didn't give him any pointers. I remember when we made that, it was very strange making Halloween 3. Because my real first wife at the time was in that movie. And she was in the motel. And she was in the room next door to our room in the motel. And she's the one that got all lasered out with bugs and, yeah, Garn Stevens. She was my wife. So me and Stacy are in the next room, naked in the bed, and yeah, very bizarre. She's my first wife, and not my wife anymore. Not primarily because of that movie, though. Other stuff. Life got in the way. But it was, I didn't give him any pointers at all. I barely said hello to him. He was on the edge of the scene at the bank, and he was outside the house at the wait for my dead daughter in where Gary Busey shot me through the thing. And I remember asking Tommy, he said, how do you sleep? And I said, naked. And he said, would you mind? And no, I don't, it's okay with me. So a lot of people imagine there was frontal nudity in that, but there wasn't. It was only my ass getting out of the bed. Nothing exotic about it, I didn't think. Did a play in New York a long time ago called The Changing Room, a David Story play. And The Changing Room is what the rugby over there calls their locker room. And there are 22 guys, young, virile men, New York, all struggling actors. Johnny Lithgow was in it, me and Paul Rudd. Different Paul Rudd, not the one now. And, but we all get naked sometime during the play. First, we come in street clothes and we change into uniforms. So there's a moment where everybody is naked when they're putting on their, the jock strap kind of cup thing. And then your shorts. And we, between the second and third act, after the game, we all took a bath. And they have a humongous hot tub over there in their country. Is what they all do is take a big hot tub and then change back into street clothes. So again, there is that moment where all these pink bodies from the heat because we had an actual hot tub off stage, get dressed. And it was a lot of fun. And but again, nothing erotic about it, so nobody paid attention to it. Well, for the most part. Some did. So, no. But Mel Gibson was nice during that movie, you know, Lethal Weapon. He was in a good mood, still young, still married, and not crazy. He was good. He was a good guy.
How was that?
Well, anybody else? Wait, I'll come back and play. Somebody got to have him. No? What do you want to know? Yeah? I'm sorry, what was the first movie?
That you ever enjoyed making. And not necessarily a
movie,
but just, you know,
that you enjoyed. I never made any little independent movies or anything back then. In the beginning of the first movie I ever made was The Detective with Frank Sinatra, 1968 in New York, and I was a rookie cop. It was a great experience. I didn't have a very big role, but it was wonderful. You know, first I had done, I think it might have been the first, no, I think I had done a play on Broadway before that didn't run very long, and then I did that. But I played a rookie cop who killed a black guy in a car because I thought he was reaching for a gun, but he was reaching for a driver's license in the dashboard. But there were four of them in the car, and they were fleeing, and we were chasing them for some reason. And anyway, then I got chewed out at the station house because the whole city went up in flames. Everybody was protesting and hollering, and I got chewed out by Frank in the squad room. I had one scene with him. Really a nice scene. And my agent called me and said they want to see you about this Frank Sinatra movie, The Detective. Go to the Sherrilyn Hotel or some real Tony hotel on the east side of New York and meet the director, and they'll talk with you. And I went, and I walked into the room, and the director was in the room, and Frank Sinatra was in the room. And I auditioned with him. I did the scene with him in the room for the director and Frank. And when we were finished, Frank said, "That was good, kiddo, thanks." And left. And I can't remember the director's name, but he said, "Well, you got the part." So I just said, "Do you think you could be that nervous when you shoot the scene?" I said, "Christ, are you kidding me? Of course I can. My Lord, it's Frank Sinatra. I'm a kid. I could do that. That's easy." He said, "'Cause you got to be nervous because, you know, the whole city is going nuts, and the chief of detectives or the head detective is chewing you up." So, yeah, it was great. Great experience. We had a wonderful time. Here's a little side thing you never knew. We shot some of the chase scene in the Bronx, chasing down the car with the four guys in it. But we were being towed by a camera truck. There was no car, no four guys. A camera truck and a bunch of guys on the truck and a tow bar, so I'm fake driving the car. And Patrick Mahon, an old Irish actor, was my partner. We're in uniform, he's sitting next to me, and this guy's hauling the truck, and a guy next to the camera says, before we start, "Okay, now we're gonna, we're, we're chasing under the L up here in the Bronx, and when I go like this with a flashlight, that means their car banged off one of the support columns, and you react that and, you know, turn. Geez. So he started doing it, and we get about halfway down the road, and we start howling with laughter, because it just, I tried to be serious about it, but it just made no sense at all. But we did eventually get a couple of good takes in on it, and they never put any of that in the movie. Probably because we had a twinkle in our eye the whole time. And McMahon is doing the same thing, just could not keep a straight face. Anyway, they flew us out to L.A. to do the close-up of when we finally pull the car over and I shoot the guy. And we're on the back lot of 20th Century Fox, and it's supposedly a New York street, and we come hauling into this alley, and they go slamming into a bunch of boxes and kind of crash their car, and I pull up behind them, and the lights are on, and the siren, shut the siren off, get up and walk up to the car, first rehearsal, and it's four white guys in blackface. And I said, whoa, what the hell is this? We're stuntmen. Yeah, so, you know, we don't have any black stuntmen. No shit. That was 1967, 8, somewhere in there. So it was after that that black stuff got in. I thought it was really weird. Kind of unnerving. Strange. Yeah? Jimmy, George, anybody? Harry? Yeah?
The Chief. It's a one-man show I do in Pittsburgh, where I live in the Pittsburgh area.
Don't send anything to me there. If you find my ad, I will throw it right in the shit can. I don't respond to anything that comes ends up coming to my house. But in for 10 years, I've done a play. It's a one-man show about Art Rooney, who's the original founder and owner of the Pittsburgh Steelers. He's dead now. He'd be about 110, I guess, if he was alive. 113. He was born in 1901. He's a great guy, a great character, a great Damon Runyon kind of a guy. He loved betting the horses. He owned race horses. He wrote numbers. He smuggled booze during Prohibition out of Chicago with some guys. But he was also an incredible Catholic and a great family man, and raised five sons and was married all of his life to the same woman, Kathleen Cass. And there's a little Catholic church on the north side of Pittsburgh, St. Peter's, that would have died long ago if it hadn't been for his personal financial support of the church. It's just a tiny church over in the German section. And that's my favorite role on stage. And for 10 years I've done it, and although we're not doing it this year. But I am, when I get back home the day after Thanksgiving, we start rehearsals for Scrooge. Well, a musical Christmas carol, but I play Scrooge, and it's the seventh year that I've done that, and that's a lot of fun. Although I was just thinking this morning, when I got up and was coming down here to set up the table, I thought, God damn, I'm really tired, and that's... Every Saturday we had three shows, Scrooge, and I thought, I hope I can get through it this year. I don't know. My legs are getting tired. So
Yeah, those are probably my two favorites. But I did a lot of theater in the early days from 67 up over east in New York and Long Wharf Theater in Connecticut, which is a regional equity theater house, and Williamstown Theater, which is the best summer theater in the country. Bradley Cooper just went and did a play there, I think last summer or two summers ago. Great, great theater. That was, they were some of the most fun, best years of my life. I was young and I had no responsibilities. They were just pure joy. Yeah, great time. And I still do it now, theater. Yeah. The Fog, we had a wonderful time doing The Fog up in Northern California in Bodega Bay, where Alfred Hitchcock shot the Birds. We were up there. Ray's Point, where the lighthouse was that Adrian Barbeau was in, being a radio DJ. And Petaluma and Inverness. They're all in the same kind of area. And it's just a beautiful, beautiful part of the country and of California and anywhere. And we, it was a sweet time, really good time. We spent all our time up there. We didn't go back and forth from. We all stayed in a funny little, it's like a motel, only it's, they're little A-frame mini houses. And everyone had a stove, and they would put wood on the little porch every day because it always got cold at night. And yeah, that was just a great experience. Adrienne and John were going together at the time. I'm not sure they were married. They might have been, but they were going together, and John Carpenter and her. And they bought a house up in Inverness because they liked it so much. Really neat house, all cedar, glass, had a grass roof on it. Yeah, really neat. And it had a fireplace that you build a fire in the fireplace, and had a radiator behind the fireplace that was connected to pipes under the floor that made the whole house warm. Oh, it was a great place. It burned down, unfortunately. Oh yeah, I'm sad. It ended up burning down years later, but we had a wonderful time shooting. It was funny because those were the days where they didn't have CGI. And to see Tommy Lee Wallace down the end of the street with a little machine and a fan trying to make fog and trying to make it look threatening and ominous to this whole little village. It was just, oh my God, we had to wait hours and hours for things to get to the point where John thought it was okay to shoot. Yeah. What else? It was great working with Janet Lee and Jamie. They were both really sweet. One of Jamie's, not her first, one of her first things she ever, well, I think she had done Halloween before it and then The Fog. But her mom was an old pro, and they had a good time working together. We all did. It was just a real nice, nice time. Yeah, liked it. One of my favorite jobs was, again, you know, it's like the job didn't matter so much as I played Xena's father, Atrix, in one episode of Xena, which they shot entirely in So I got a call from my agent and said, now, this has come up real quick. Do you want to do it or not? If you want to do it, it's going to happen within a week. And they'll fly you and your wife and your son to New Zealand for 2 weeks to do a Zena. I said, absolutely, I'm in, sure. Let's go. So they did that, and they put us up in a wonderful apartment on top of a building, like a penthouse apartment in Auckland. You could see the entire New Zealand Navy across the bay, two ships. and it was just, what a wonderful experience that was. Great being way down there in the bottom half of the world, and food was good, and the people were really friendly, and it felt like the United States in the late 50s, early 60s. There's an old-fashioned feel about it, a lot of black sand beaches, and you didn't have to go very far out of town to get to location to shoot where we were shooting. And one of the problems they had were the cicadas that made a lot of noise. So they had a whole crew of a half a dozen people walking around with big sticks. And when they were getting ready to do a scene, these guys would start banging all these trees and bushes with their sticks, and they'd get quiet for just about long enough to do a 2 minute take. Then they'd start up again. Constant din of them. On the way over, before we went, I told them, they said, you know, when you first get here, they'll take you right to your apartment, then you have to come for a costume fitting and makeup tests and stuff, and you have to meet your horse. And I said, no, I don't ride. I don't know how to ride a horse. And they said, well, don't worry, you know, they'll just expect you to sit on it and look good. And I said, okay. So I went, and we met the horse at a little riding arena. And I got up on it, and she said, okay, so do a little canter. I said, what's that? Does a horse know if I say canter, will it do it? And she said, oh, you really don't ride. I said, I told you, I don't ride. I don't know anything about horses. Except they're bigger than me, and I'm not John Wayne. I'm not that guy. And so they built me a riding, like a saddle on a platform on top of an ATV with the horse's head in front of it and the mane kind of blowing back in my face, and we are charging across this campus, and I'm screaming, Zena! Zena! Help! And she came to my aid. And they would cut away from the close-up of me doing that to a long shot of a stuntman on a horse, you know, looking like me. And it looked great. And I was stunned that it did, because I thought, man, does this feel cheesy to me? But it worked. Yeah. And the best part, she hurt her back. We don't know for sure if she really hurt her back, but they had to shut down the show for 4 days. And the producer said, I'm sorry, Tom, we had to shut down the show for 4 days. Lucy hurt her back, but we'll do work on that. What was the other guy? There was a guy that shot a show. Same kind of show, sort of. What? Yeah. Right on the next set, sort of. He said, we'll go
work a little bit on that show. Meantime, you have 4 days that you and your wife and son can see the rest of New Zealand. Go down to the South Island, Queenstown, and so, that was great. That was great. So we did do that. We were able to do that, explore the whole country, and then go to Hawaii on the way back, stop in L.A., and then back home, Pittsburgh. One of the best jobs ever. Yeah.
Out of all the horror movies you've done, which one do you think was the worst in the kind of scare before you? What action had like the worst in mind?
Which one is what?
What out of all the horror movies you've done, which one do you think you found to be the scariest?
The scariest?
Scariest, yeah.
Of all of them?
Yeah, all of them.
I have no idea. I mean, I was in them, so I made them. They're not going to scare me because I know what they are. I think it's up to you. What do you think was the scariest? You know?
I don't know, but I know I love the fog.
Yeah. Yeah. I love the fog too, and I think John was very worried about the fog, because it was so unlike Halloween, and he was afraid that, you know, and he said when we were getting ready to do it, this is an old-fashioned ghost story, and I don't know that it's going to be a good movie or not. I loved the opening that he had with the old, I can't remember the old fella, he's dead now. John Houseman, who told the story around the campfire to all the little kids, and then the camera went up and into the dark, and then it came down over Bodega Bay, and where, I love that. I would say that's probably one of the good scary ones. But he did goose it up at the beginning with he added all that stuff about stuff falling off the store shelves and the gas thing coming out of the pump, and I don't know, did it catch on fire or not? And yeah, all the opening stuff of weird things going on, he added because he didn't think it had a good enough jump into it. Yeah. Anybody else? How are we doing? Oh, we're good. Yeah?
What was your experience making Maniac Cop?
Not one of my favorites. Maniac Cop was not one of my favorites because Bill Lustig hired me to be basically the star of that movie, and then a third of the way through it, I go out a window and die on top of a cat. And I thought, what the hell, man? Come on. People are going to be pissed off at coming to a movie, Tom Atkins, Sputton, and Maniac Cop, and I'm dead. I heard the way through. And I see Bruce Campbell occasionally at these, and he said, oh, I know. He said, that was terrible, wasn't it? He said, the next one, I died in buying a newspaper or something. The most ignominious, non-eventful death. Somebody walks up and stabs me and I'm dead, or shoots him, I don't know. But yeah, Lustig is an odd fellow for the way he does it. Other than that, it was fun. You know, pleasant enough, shot it down around L.A.
You know, the one Hitchcock did it with Janet, we had Psycho.
Yeah, I know.
That's the star.
I know, yeah. Yeah, yeah, but Lustig does it. Repeatedly, it seems like. Hitchcock did it once, I think, and with her, yeah. And that was, yeah, it was stunning. I heard that in that, yeah. Yeah.
Is it different shooting a 3D movie like My Bloody Valentine?
What about it?
Was there anything different about production?
Oh, no. It was 3D, and we had to do, We had to do camera tests or something with the 3D. But I found in the making of the movie, it was like making any other movie. It might have been different for the crew and the camera operators and the cameramen and the director and the lighting guys and the gaffers and the grips, but for me and the actors, I think it was the same. Just kind of hit your mark, say your words, don't get in the way of anything. The only thing different for me personally was my hair is white. It's like Eric Roberts over there, his hair is gray. Mine is white, and it popped too much in the movie, and they had to make it gray. So they sprayed shit on it to make it gray. And it stunk. Like perfume, it was real sweet. I didn't like that part of it, but I enjoy making the movie, and but as far as the production, yeah, nothing different for me. But a nice little side story about that. Patrick, I didn't know Patrick, but he was a big fan, and he called the casting agent. He knew he was coming to Pittsburgh to shoot the whole movie shot in the Pittsburgh area. And he said to this woman, I think Tom Atkins lives in your area. And she said, sure, yeah, I know Tom. Well, I wanted to be in this movie. Do you think you could arrange a meeting between him and me? And she said, yeah, sure. So she called me up, and Patrick and I met for coffee at this wonderful old hotel, downtown Pittsburgh. And I'll tell you, 5 minutes after I'm with him and talking with him, I felt like I had known him all my life. He was really, really terrific guy, easy to be with, really nice. And he said, look, I want you to play the sheriff in this part. It's a nice part, it's not a real big part, but it's a nice part. And I think you would enjoy it, but I'm only afraid that when I tell you how you die, you may not want to do it. And he told me, you know, that half my face goes flying out over everybody's right shoulder in the movie theater into the corner, and in 3D, and I said, ah, that sounds great, man, let's do it, man. That'll be fun. And it was fun. And little Gary Huntcliffe, or Suncliffe, or whatever his name is, who did the special effects, he had me do a death head, grimacing death head, at Tom Savini's place in Pittsburgh, in Manessen. And then he built everything he needed from that. And I thought it worked great. I thought it was one of the best deaths in the movie. Although I particularly liked the girl whose head was on a spade, shoved up against a post, and then her head slid down the spade. Ooh, man. That was grim. Grim. Yeah, the guy in the back. I'm sorry, I can't hear you.
What was it like to work with Lee Van Cleef and Escape from New York?
Lee Van Cleef and Escape from New York was, he and I ran the prison and put the exploding thing in Kurt Russell's neck, Snake Plissken, who everybody thought was dead. Snake Plissken, I thought you were dead. Lee was great. We shot a lot at the Jet Propulsion Lab in outside of Pasadena. We shot a lot of our stuff there, and at the Sepulveda Dam. Now, I got to shoot a scene at the Statue of Liberty in New York, coming down the stairs and into a phone booth and talk to Lee, supposedly up on top. And he was a sweet guy, kind of quiet, smoked a pipe, would sit around, you know, on the set, never went to his dressing room and hid away or anything. Though he had cancer at the time, and he knew it, and he knew he was not going to get better from it, but he was really a wonderful guy, very professional, there every day, never missed, and
He was great. I admire him from all the work he did, all the wonderful westerns he made. Man, he was a squinty-eyed guy, and if he squinted your eyes at you, you knew you were in trouble. He was a good guy, good actor. Yeah, anybody? One of the weirdest jobs I ever had was a thing called Ninth Configuration. And we went to Hungary for 2.5 months to shoot it. William Peter Blatty wrote it, produced it, directed it. And I have often thought, anybody ever see it? One guy. That's the thing, it's a weird, weird movie. And I often thought, a movie of the making of that movie would have been a much better movie. And funny. It was just crazy. 23 American guys stuck in Hungary where you cannot speak any of the language unless you are Hungarian. I overheard a bartenderess talking on the phone for 10 minutes. And at the end of the phone call, I said, this was a month after I was there, I said, did you say somewhere in that conversation, never mind? And she said, yes. Nem boy. It's no matter. I said, I knew that. I sussed that out. It's amazing. Period. That's all the words I know. Christenem, thank you. Christenem Szépen, thank you very much. And my favorite Hungarian word is Hortobágy. And it means the great plains outside of, on the edge of Hungary and whatever the hell's behind it. I forget. But, oh my God, there was Moses Gunn, Neville Brand, Jason Miller, Joe Spinell, Stacy Keach, the Brit, he got kicked out of the country. He was a star, oh my God. The guy in Robin and Marion, but not Sean Connery, the other guy. Anybody know him?
Robert Shaw?
I can never remember his name, what?
Robert Shaw?
No. No, yeah, he was in that, but no, this was Robin's right-hand man, blonde guy. Anyway, he was going through a terrible divorce in England, and in Hungary, it was 1978, we were still behind the Iron Curtain, but we were in the Hilton Hotel, which was always, I never understood that. And you would be in the middle of a phone call to your wife or a friend and somebody at home, and it would disappear. Phone call would just go away, it would end. Oh. Well, oh God, it makes me nuts, I can't remember his name. Anyway, he was in the middle of one of those one too many times, talking to his barrister or whatever in England about the divorce, and the phone went dead. And he ripped the phone out of the wall, threw it out the window, and he was on the fifth floor of the, it was a sixth floor hotel. There was a disco on the sixth, and we were all five and under. And he was on the fifth floor. Everything in that room that would go out that window went out that window. And they came, and we were only a week and a half into the movie, and they, they came and took him away, and then Blatty had to go and get him out of wherever they took him. And they said, he's out of the country. He's gone. And Blatty said, he's a star in my movie, for God's sake. And they said, sorry, he's gone. So. Huh? Nicole Williams. I can't hear you. No, Nicole Williamson. Nicole Williamson. I think that's his name. He
So he got kicked out of the country. Stacy Keach came over to take his place. Scott in Walking Dead guy, Scott Wilson, he got bumped up from something to something. And oh my God, it was, oh Jesus, what a cast. Just crazy. One of the best bar fights I've ever been part of in my life happened during the making of that movie. The sixth floor disco, Jason Miller was in love with the girl that he had met at the American Consulate where we used to go to hang out, because when they were else, would shoot pool and drink beer and talk with the Marines and security people. And Jason had fallen in love with this American girl at the consulate, dancing one night. We're out the sixth floor disco, Moses Gunn, myself, Joe Spinell, Jason Miller, and Scott Wilson. And having cocktails, as you might say. And across the room is the girl with the Nigerian ambassador. And Jason is out of his mind with booze and rage. And he keeps saying low under his, I'm gonna kill her. I'm gonna kill her, look at her. I'm gonna go kill her. Finally, Joe Spinell said, Jason, there ain't nothing to it but to do it. Jason charged across the room, leaped at the guy over the table, but came up short and landed on the table. And the guy picked up a bottle and started banging him on the head, saying, you American bastard, you American bastard. And Joe Spinell picked up a bottle from the bar and went over and hit the Nigerian ambassador on the head. And they couldn't be deported. Though they wanted to, they knew within 5 minutes everybody's name in the entire disco, who was in there, who did what, and who. And William Peter Blatty said, oh please, oh, listen, God, we're, you know, almost finished with the movie. I cannot send these guys home. I cannot, we have to finish the movie. And they said, okay, Spinell's gonna live in that hotel over in that part of town, and Jason's gonna live in this hotel over here, and one more bit of trouble and you're all gone. And so we got through the rest of it and made it. But I swear to God, a movie of the making of that movie would have been more interesting and more fun. Okay, any more? One more, and then I think we're done. No? We're done. Well, okay, fine.
I got a question.
Are there
in
any
Halloween
3?
No, right here.
Are there any roles that you turned down that you regret turning down in hindsight?
No, I never turned. I took every job anybody ever said. There is one job that I was offered that I could not get out of a play to do that I've always regretted, that I was sorry that I couldn't get out. But we were doing The Changing Room, and Katherine Hepburn was about to do a television version of Glass Menagerie. And like Hallmark Hall of Fame, or yeah, some a special deal on TV. And I went to audition for that, and the same thing happened. I went into the room with the producer, Lee Susskind was the producer, and she was in the room. And I was there to audition for the role of the gentleman caller. It was a great role in Tennessee Williams' play. And she read with me as Laura, the young girl, her daughter, in the play. And as we finished the scene, she was crying, you know, tears running down her face, and Susskind said, wow. And I always remember her saying, see, that's acting. That's a good actor. And they offered me the role, but I could not get out of changing room to do it. I just could not. They wouldn't let me buy the contract. They just wouldn't let me out to do it. So somebody else did it. I can't remember his name. And he, actually, he was in a ninth configuration. He got fired. That guy. Oh, Jesus. He was on that criminal, the three-part.
Law and Order.
Yeah, Law and Order.
Wasn't it Moriarty?
Early days. Michael
Moriarty.
Moriarty. He was the young guy in ninth configuration, and Blatty adopted him before the movie as a Catholic. Because Mike was struggling with his religion. Blatty was a confirmed big Catholic guy. And he adopted Michael Moriarty as a Catholic, not as a son, but, and they rehearsed for a year. We get over there on the set, first day, Blatty says, a scene between Moriarty and Eddie Flanders. And he said, action. And Moriarty said, oh, Bill, you know, I'm not sure what you want from this scene. And Blatty said, we rehearsed a year. You know, I he was waiting for a plane the next day. He was gone. Honest to God, what a movie. Okay, thanks a lot, folks.